Hi, my name is Johnny Hübner, and this is Jackass. Yeah, why that cheesy introduction? Because I'm building another charger. Oh god, no. So this is what we have. I'm trying to put this in a kind of perspective. So let's start from the most important side here. This is a Toyota Prius inductor, probably good for like 80 to 100 amps. The matching IPM, intelligent power module from the Prius, with all the protection built in. Yeah, probably good for the same current. Pre-charge resistor, simple three-phase mains rectifier, I think also good for 100 amps. Yeah, well, you tell me. Is there really no numbers on here? Oh, on the other side. Oh, good for 100 amps. Then here we have a simple 12-volt power supply. A combined input and output relay. So it will, when it pulls, it will short out the pre-charge resistor and also switch the DC through to the output, which my previous charger did not do. They were always live, so that's already a safety improvement. Yes, then we have the well-known Revision 2 mainboard that runs the charger software. We have a DC link capacitor that's going to be placed somehow here. And this big box in the back is supposed to house all that. And also, yeah, it kind of just fits because the last component here is going to be a large fan to keep things cool. I might design it to use a Type 2 inlet with all the PWM to set the power limit. And yeah, use an Anderson connector for outputting the power and one of my custom 7-pin connectors to run the Shodemo protocol. Yes, so that's the basic components. The reason why this is Jackass is because it's not really compliant. Like, normally you would have to use one of those grid filters to be nice to the grid and not throw too much switching noise in there. But I certainly don't have space for that, and also this is only a, does it say, I think a 16 amp filter, so we would be limited to roughly 11 kilowatts in power, and I am planning to run more like 20 kilowatts. Yeah, so let's not do filtering. Meaning this video is only educational. Don't repeat this at home. Don't even think about it. Now to start out with, we are going to wire up this IPM. And it's using this quite generic 16-pole connector. I will put the part number in the description or as a video overlay. And it's commonly used in like the Nissan Leaf on the BMS, for example, and apparently also in the Prius for both this IPM and also for the main contactor that goes into the inverter that this comes from. So I will wire this up now and we are going to do some PWMing. So it's all wired up. Most signals are on the top row here. We've got a 12-volt supply, which takes in a hefty like 4 watts. Ground, then the yellow one is the actual PWM. Open collector with pull-up. Blue is another 5-volt supply, whatever that's used for and why it's not created internally. And then white is a universal voltage signal, so basically you can see this wire on the far side. It seems to have some guard distance from all the other wires. And in the Prius inverter, that's just hooked up to the positive here. and then you get a 1-to-100 version of that signal on the blue wire. No, on the white wire. The blue wire is a temperature signal. It's linear, and the higher the voltage, the cooler the module. So currently it sits at 4.44. And as it heats up, this voltage is going to drop. And then finally on the bottom row, which you can see, we have an enable signal that we have constantly pulled to ground. So the module is always enabled, which means if we don't clock it, it's just going to connect the two upper connections here. And then we have another ground, like logic ground or something, that we've also tied to ground right here. And then also on the bottom finally is a fault signal, comes here out here on the brown wire, and it sits at 15 volts apparently if everything is okay, and probably drops down to something else when we have I don't know, DSAT or something. Okay, let's quickly test this white signal. So it's going to be sitting at roughly half a volt when it's not connected to anything. And now we connect this to our input voltage, and it shoots up to 0.9 volts. So we have a nice isolated voltage measurement, which means that in our charger we can have input and output voltage measured. So I'm going to measure probably the input voltage with the open inverter voltage sense board, and the output voltage with that. Good. Next step is to assemble it, and finally I'm currently clocking it with the analog discovery, and we're getting a nice square, well, not really a nice square wave, but because it's unloaded, we are getting a kind of rounded off square wave. So all working as expected. Yeah, so and finally some credit to a Spanish guy who kind of mapped out all the connections of the boost converter module. Yeah, so next step is going to wire this all up in the assembly that I showed you down in the shed, and test it. Stand by. Okay, and funny enough, I've kind of located another sort of enable signal, because we are using the analog discovery for the 5 volt supply. And it turns out if that 5 volt supply isn't enabled, neither top or bottom IGBTs seem to be switched on. So as soon as I switch it on, boom, shorts out our power supply, meaning the bottom IGBT is on. And now if I enable the PWM, it starts boosting, and we're seeing a 300 volt here on the DC bus, as denoted by this isolated voltage measurement of 3.3 volts. Okay, one intermediate step. So we've got our main contactor, so the three phases are going to be all switched. We'll then run to the rectifier here. Rectified, minus and plus, go to the power module right here. That then clocks our big inductor, and then we have our output voltage going back to the fourth fourth contact of the relay, and exits here, and minus just permanently exits. Also, I've decided so that this one is going to be bridged by a resistor. So as soon as we close the car side relay, we are going to pre-charge our main bus cap. It's not this one, it's going to be a bigger one. Pre-charge our main bus cap to the battery voltage, say 350 volts, and then we're going to run this in boost mode to actually pre-charge it to rectified mains, so say 560 volts. And then once that is done, we can close the main contactor and start charging. So as you can see from the mess here, there is progress. I have kind of made a 12 volt and ground junction point in this terminal block right here and hooked up the power module to the main board here, and I will show you in a minute what I did exactly. Yes, power wise we have, it's kind of covered by the capacitor right now, we have the three phases coming into the rectifier right here, plus and minus bus bars right here, snubber cap here, and a larger cap, bus cap right here. It's going to be bolted to the sidewall. Yes, and then we go into our inductor and come out of our inductor, go through current sensor, and then out in the same contactor that will connect to the DC output. And then, kind of hidden right somewhere behind here, we have a power resistor. And that is going to bridge this very contactor. So as soon as we close the car side relays, we are charging the bus cap to whatever the battery voltage is through the inductor, through the diode into the cap. And then say it sits at 330 volts. But the grid voltage that we are going to rectify and feed in here is going to rectify to 560 volts. So the plan here is to take that voltage and boost it, because it's a bidirectional converter, so we can boost it, and then we are going to boost until we reach 560 volts on plus and minus right here, and then we can actually close the contactor. Yes, in more detail, here is the sort of glue logic I came up with. So these are the contacts of the power module. IGCT is just a 12 volt power supply. OVH is sort of an enable signal. It's supposed to be 5 volts. And if it's not, both bottom and top side IGBTs are switched off. So that's very handy. Yes, and that is fed by 5 volts through a 100 ohm resistor. And I can choose to turn that off by means of an open collector driver on the main board. Then we have some fault signals here, over voltage and general fault. I'm not using these, wouldn't know what for. Here we have the voltage that I have. It's a free sense wire, it's not connected internally, and I've connected it to the output voltage of the converter. So it measures the battery voltage. Okay, then the most clue logic is, oh wait, so the voltage, it's divided by two. So we have a 10k resistor here and we have a 10k resistor here on board. So so we actually stay below the 3.3 volt limit of our STM32. Yes, CPWM. So that is pulled high. Oh, sorry, that's the wrong value here. That is pulled high by 500 ohms to 12 volts. So it defaults to, I think, the lower IGBT closed. And then we have a simple, you might even see it somewhere here. Yeah, here it is. Simple BC type transistor that we use for switching. And that is connected to our PWM output, JP32, on the main board. And finally, yes, we have the CT signal. So that's the temperature of our converter module. And that is also divided by two externally, 10k, 10k, and then fed into the temperature input of the mainboard. And we have three grounds here. So this is kind of the power ground. And, whoops. Then we have ground converter, which is more like a logical ground. This one right here, that's just bridged. And then we have a shutdown signal that enables the module when it's being pulled to ground. So we always pull that to ground and use that one for shutting down. Yes. And then finally we have this little 7-watt fan on the end of the heatsink. Not sure if that's going to suffice. It's connected to the user PWM, so it's going to be temperature controlled, and this is going to be hooked up to 12 volts. Okay, let's do a quick little test. I'm just feeding DC from my power supply in here. Of course, you're not using grid voltages yet. And then I've just shorted out the output plus and minus. So we're just going to drive some current through the inductor. Good. I will enable. And then set a set point of, say, 10 amps. Here we go. 10 amps. 10.2. So, I think it's starting to look pretty schmick. So, all tied up in this enclosure here. There's going to be some holes for the fan inlet in the back here. And in the front here, show demo logic signals. This is nothing. This is the AC input, and the DC output is not yet here yet. And there's going to be the little 7-segment display for displaying current or maybe SOC. This AC input is a bit preliminary. I was looking into something more substantial to be able to get up to 22 kilowatts. But for testing now, that is what I have. Now let's open it up. Put the camera down because it's pretty heavy. And here it is, bus capacitor, power supply, Anderson outlet, logic board, and all that is now lying down. And I have used 6 bolts to bolt the heatsink to the enclosure, and 1 bolt to bolt this DIN rail. Here's the bolt. Could look better. To bolt the DIN rail to the enclosure and put the contactor and power supply on it. Okay, now we just test the pre-charging. No power yet. No CANCOMs apparently. Okay, let's start by hand, see if it pre-charges. And I will plot UDC while doing so. And run. Okay, that seemed to have worked. Yes, so I've set the pre-charge voltage to 500 watts. And as you might be able to see, yeah, high-tech camera work here, it actually overshot to 610 volts. But apart from that, it's now in run mode and normally it would actually charge. Okay, now it's getting serious. I've wired up the full 3-phase. Let's see what happens. Okay, at least it didn't blow up or overcurrent. So, it's gotten kind of late. And I had to essentially disable the overcurrent strip from the current sensor. Because when switching on the relay, it would just trip out always. with or with no grid connected. Yeah, but now we're charging from 3-phase, 10 kilowatts. Good to see. Good, so let me wrap this up. So we have been charging successfully. The noise is pretty awful because I have to switch at 8.8 kHz because the Prius IPM doesn't like higher frequencies. I can try allowing intermediate frequencies like 10 or 12 kHz. That should sound less awful, but yeah, well, I'm gonna be away while it's charging, so let's not worry too much about it. Yes, things to do. Drill some holes for the fan. Drill a hole for the DC outlet. And kind of, I don't know, find out how I can actually bolt it down somewhere meaningful. What else? Any more holes? Oh yeah, drill a hole for the display. And also test it on a stronger 22 kilowatt outlet to see how much power we can actually get out of that. Of course, to do that, I would have to replace this wimpy 1.5 square inlet by a... I have a Type 2 socket in the basement, actually. And yeah, I would just bolt this right in to the input relay to have a reliable connection. And I would have liked to integrate a Type 2 socket somewhere here anyway, because it's much more slick than having a cable stick out. But as you can see, there's no space left, I suppose. We would almost need like, I don't know, 1/3 of this volume here to fit it. And we just do not have the space. So, cable it's gonna be. I've also made a bit of a change to the integrated voltage sense, which usually tops out at around 500 volts. But we need to go a little bit further, like 580, 600 volts. So I just added a series resistor, 680K. And internally, this seems to have a resistor ladder of roughly 600K. So we're kind of doubling the voltage range on that. So I think that's it for now. I hope you enjoyed this little Prius charging video. Prius component charging video. And yeah, that's it for now. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Bye bye.